the open funding options that most people have are either debt or equity. Let's look at equity. This is equity as we all know it. We use the word common stock or normal equity shares. So for example, if somebody has, let's say a company XYZ has 1,000 shares floated, and out of that Mr. A has 300 shares, then A is a 30% owner of XYZ. So raising capital by share issue of shares is an important method of raising long-term funds. In India, the way we know equity, there are two types of equity. One is the common equity or equity shares, and the second is preference shares. I will not go into the details of the preference shares. Equity shares are, as all of you know, are those that are traded on the stock markets, and you see the prices going up and down on a daily basis. Let's look at debt to set. Who is debt issued by? Debt is issued by a company. It is issued to expand its business. For how long a period is debt issued? Typically bonds or debentures, the way we understand them, are for periods that for at least a year, that can go up to maybe 7 years, 8 years, 10 years, depending on how good an idea has the company has about interest rates in the years going ahead, and what it thinks is its capacity to service that debt. Because as you know, only when it makes profit can it service the debt, right? Debt is listed on most of the major stock exchanges. So in India, for example, you have trading that takes place on the wholesale debt market and the retail debt market. On the stock exchanges, that is the BSE and the NSE. You also have a lot of trading that takes place in debt on the through the OTC route. In the sense, the trades are negotiated through brokers directly by the parties and reported on the exchanges, that is BSE or NSE. The other option is that trading takes place in other securities like government securities through RBI administered networks. So we have there's a specific market called NDS, that is negotiated dealing system, which is supervised by the RBI, and it is the trading and settlement takes place through the Clearing Corporation of India. We all expect that the equity markets are much larger than the debt markets, but the debt markets also have a significant size. In India, the size of the debt market or the bond market was about 812 billion in 2014. Now, once entrepreneurs come up with some idea, what do? The first thing they do is they have to look for a way to finance that idea or finance that business. So the first people they talk to normally are friends, maybe associates, maybe well-wishers, and then they finally go to the bank or the financial institution. So for example, I have a brilliant idea as an entrepreneur. So I first think of putting in whatever part of my savings I can to finance that company. Thereafter, I might call up some of my best friends and say, hey, this is a great idea. So why don't you also invest some money into this? Then I might go to my suppliers, the people who supply me certain raw materials or interest or some inputs into my business, and convince them that the idea is good and therefore it's worthwhile investing into it, so that they'll make a good amount of money on it. So those are my associates. Well-wishers could be other family members, friends who believe in me, and they would like to also invest in such an idea. Once I have a certain minimum amount of capital, I might go across to a bank or a financial institution and put forward my idea to them. Because as you know, businesses start with a combination of some part of equity and some part of debt. Why debt? It's because you require the currently most of the, at least in the startup stage, many companies have a certain minimum amount of equity and maybe slightly more of debt. So debt is slightly more expensive in the initial stages because you don't know how much money you're going to make, what your revenues and how much profit you have and how much money you would have to service the debt. But in the long, equity is more expensive than debt because in the case of debt, you do not have to dilute your shareholding. First thing is that many friends and well-wishers do not understand the business and they are unwilling to take the risk. So let's take for example the fact that you have so many sites which are into selling different products and different services. Now you could maybe buy something, groceries maybe, stationery maybe, you could go to the shop next door and buy it. So why did it require or why was there a business opportunity available for so many other websites to come up? Typically, if you wanted to go and buy clothes, don't go into a shop, look at the material, look at the way that the fall of the texture, the dress or the garment, wear it for yourself, try 15 versions and then think which is good for you. And think which is good and only then you would buy it. So why is it, how is it that a company like maybe a Snapdeal or a Flipkart or anybody for the matter, how is it that they actually make money? If you were to go and ask this one of your friends and well-wishers saying that I have this website in which I want to sell, let's say, clothes online, or let's say I want to sell books online, or I want to sell shoes online, people may have thought of it as a stupid idea, at least in India. But we had the example of companies like Amazon, which did something similar in the US. So what we think is an opportunity and a risk, it actually may not seem so sensible to friends or well-wishers of ours. And they may not think that it's a risk worth taking. They may not think that this market is a business opportunity and there's a chance for anybody to make money out of it. And therefore, they may not support the idea. So that is one cause. Second cause is, sometimes what happens is that a project starts off and in the beginning you are busy running after so many other things. So the revenues in the beginning are not very, very high. To build that up, you require a certain amount of customer base. Once you build up the customer base, then you can actually start making money. But people may not understand that it takes 2 years or 3 years or 4 years to build up a customer base. The first 2 or 3 years, you are, as they say in the normal jargon that we use, you're just burning cash. You're just spending and the benefits will come out in the long term. They're not seen in the short term. So the person who's funding your at their business, the question to him is always, are you making money? Are you actually making money right from the beginning? Because for that, the answer is no. And when that answer to them is no, they're worried whether they should invest with you. Third thing, talk about banks. Banks will first of all ask you, how much money have you put into that project? If you don't put a significant amount in that project, they will not fund you for the rest of it. There are many reasons for that. First of all, if you do not put in a significant amount of money, it means you yourself are not very confident about how the project is going to work out, how the business is going to work out. So it's very important that you have to put in a significant amount of that. But then the point is, you yourself may not have that many savings, so you have to convince other people and get that money, and only then can you go to banks or any financial institutions and ask them to put in some money into that project. Banks, of course, if you talk of the IT sector, this is one problem that they have. Banks are always looking at hypothecating some assets against the loans that they give to you. So if it's a table, if it's a chair, if it's a machinery, it's something that they see, touch, feel, and therefore they're more confident lending against those particular assets. But what do you do about businesses where most of the capital is actually the human mind? So if you talk of IT, if you talk of e-commerce, a lot of the stuff that you deal in is not owned by you. For a company that's into IT, into software, for example, what assets does it have? It has some computers, some software, some hardware. If you understand one thing, that these assets can be depreciated very fast. So in a year or 2 years, the value of those assets is next to nil. So therefore, what hard assets does a company have that it can hypothecate to a bank? So banks are a bit worried before they lend to companies into such businesses. But the fact is, these businesses are viable business opportunities and extremely profitable business opportunities. If you take a company like Uber, you take, or Airbnb, they don't own any assets. They make money by providing a service. Those assets are not owned by them. They are only intermediaries. They've set up brilliant platforms for somebody to take advantage of those platforms. They are just intermediaries between the provider of a service and the user of the service. And yet they're making a lot of money out of that. But if companies like those were to go to Indian banks, possibly they would not get much funds out of the bank. Any business takes 2 to 5 years to break even. Depending on what type of business it is, this period will differ from business to business. So it's very important that the person who's investing in a business understands that. You must know the fact that once you put in the money, it will take a certain amount of time for you to build up a certain amount of goodwill, a certain amount of brand presence, to attract a lot of customers, because in whichever business you go into, there's a lot of competition. If you take some of the new companies that have come into different sectors, which seemed, on the face of it, already saturated, you still see a lot of potential in those businesses, but yet they will take time to actually break even. So some of the companies in the e-commerce sector right now are just about starting to break even at the gross level, not at the actual net level. So they don't perfectly fit the type of companies that are listed on the stock exchanges, where we look at, for us on the stock exchanges, profit after tax is a sacrosanct figure. Every analyst or every investor looks at only that figure. But when you talk of new ventures, you have to keep this in mind, that it will take 2 to 5 years to break even, and then the real profitability of the company will start. And finally, there's a general lack of risk-taking culture in India. If you look at investments in India, you'll understand one thing, that about 60% of India's investors invest in bank deposits. So bank deposits, you might call it the post office deposits. The amount of investment that goes into equities per se is maybe less than 10%. So with that less amount of risk-taking culture that we have in India, it's not very easy for new entrepreneurs with new ideas which are path-breaking, which are revolutionary, to go to the same conventional sources of finance and ask for funds. So what do these people do? They have to look for new options. So let us look at those particular options now, one by one. Before we get into that, let's look at the way small businesses actually get money. Now there are a lot, and if you take small businesses, lending to those businesses is riskier than its large business lending. Why? Because, for example, these are extremely competitive sectors. You take, for example, a laundry business. There are many, many laundries. There is that person who comes to your house, that dhobi who comes to your house every day or every second day, and he takes away some clothes to be washed. So what is so different about his business? Suppose the same, you go from that into buying a laundromat and starting a business. It might require more work, more capital to be put in, but in the long run, you might make much more money compared to the person who's a normal dhobi. But the fact is, those businesses are very risky still. These businesses, small businesses, are much more sensitive to swings in the economy. So for example, if you take, let's say, the same example, I would say, a person who is maybe in the business of washing, suddenly there is a new technology that comes in for washing, which reduces the cost of washing by, let's say, one third or one fourth. Then suddenly you find that the laundromat that is being used is now out of business. So there is a lot of risk that they face, and because these are businesses which everybody uses, and therefore it makes the lending to those businesses much riskier. The search costs in those businesses are high for both the borrowers and lenders. Okay. We normally look at small business loans as business loans below 1 million. Compared to larger businesses, they are less profitable. As we also know one thing, in business typically the failure rate is maybe 9 to 10 or 8 to 10 out of 10. So these smaller businesses have higher failure rates, and there are fewer assets to collateralize the loan because the size of the business itself is small. So for example, if I talk of somebody who is, let's say, running an automobile garage, it typically qualifies as a small business. So you have, let's say, a garage, a person who's servicing cars from 4 or 5 different companies, and suddenly you find that, let's say, 2 year or 1 year later, there's a Maruti center which comes out, about 1 kilometer, 2 kilometers from where he stays. So many people who own Maruti cars would now prefer to get it done from an authorized dealer or an authorized garage. Why? Because they're worried that there is no chance there of them getting fake replacements or replacement parts, which could be there with the normal garage that you have. So the small guy who's doing his business at suddenly find his customers going away, and he loses not only business, he loses even the capacity to repay the loan that he's taken. So that means we are talking of higher failure rates. Now there are many questions that any investor would ask before lending money. First of all, what is the business idea? What is it that you're talking of? And how is it unique or different from that of others? So for example, if I were to say, Snapdeal or say Flipkart or say YoYoRoo, if you look at it, these are all in conventional businesses. They've only gone online. But yes, any other business like them could have gone online. So what makes these people succeed? What makes them become profitable? What is it that they have which is unique and different from the others? For example, you know one thing, that in hotels there are certain slack seasons and certain very, very busy seasons. What happens to them in the slack season? Do they have rooms going empty? If they have rooms going empty, then that is an opportunity that hotel room aggregators like YoYoRoo saw. So what they did is they have tied up with different hotels, and they found out when those rooms are empty, and accordingly you can, depending on your budget, find a room and go there. So it benefits the hotel because now for them that's a fixed cost which is not taken care of because a customer is occupying that room. So they benefit by that. Similarly, if you take companies like a Flipkart or a Snapdeal or all these large, people who sell so many different types of goods across the spectrum, they make money because of the sheer scale at which they operate, because they're dealing in thousands of orders almost on a daily basis. That is how they make money, because as you know, if you have a big scale of operations, then the margins, even if they are small in absolute numbers, they turn out to be very large numbers, and therefore it's worth it. So the third thing is, what are your costs and their breakup? So any investor will always ask you this: I pay you 100 rupees. Out of that 100 rupees, what is it that you're going to use, you're going to spend, and what is it that you're going to save out of that? Because based on that, they will get an idea as to when they think that you will break even, and you have to explain that to them as well. And therefore, thereafter, when do you think that you'll actually start making money? Now, when you talk of breaking even, you have to also keep in mind the fact that investors would also like to know what is the level of competition that you have. If you're saying that yours is not a unique product, then who are the people who are in the same market? How do you expect to compete with them? And therefore, how do you expect to make money? Right? Once you start your business, the next question is, what are you going to do after you reach a certain level? How are you going to expand? What is your contribution in the sense, as an individual, what is the business that you're doing? How do you think it's really work out? And as a team, how do you think is you're going to handle the business? And of course, how do you plan to fund in the venture? how much debt are you going to use, and how much of your own money or equity are you going to put in. So if you look at there's one field that all of us, which is very popular now, we call that the venture capital or private equity. There are different categories or different layers. Companies which are starting off from scratch, they normally go to certain investors, so-called angel investors. Angel investors are those who typically fund a project almost at inception. A slight variation of the angel investors, who are typically individuals, are what are called seed or startup funds, like Unitas and some of the others, where they actually start funding an idea almost at inception. Thereafter, once you reach a certain level of business operations, you would have venture capital funds which would be ready to invest in your business, either through equity or through debt. Thereafter, you have what are called private equity, where companies would come, private equity funds would invest you in your company, either at the secondary stage, in which case they might buy out some of the promoters of the company, and at a higher valuation than the valuation at which you started off with. And the final category is what are called hedge funds, which are high risk, high return funds. They are ready to come in at any stages of the funding point. The process can start with something as simple as what are called incubators and accelerators. So in the first, if you look at incubators, they are basically companies that help even startup companies by providing management training or office space. So you might have this at maybe the level of colleges like the IITs or the IIMs, and in some cases your professionals that actually do it, companies which would like to, for example, if there is a large software company which would like to encourage other people to develop software, then they set up either an incubator or an accelerator as well, so that they can encourage new ideas. Angel investors, I mentioned, are investors who fund new ventures close to origination. Seed funds also provide initial funding. So some of the new funding methods that we can look at, one of them is called crowdfunding. So what is crowdfunding? It is a practice of funding a project or venture by raising monetary contributions from a large number of people, today often performed by internet-mediated registries, but the concept can also be executed through mail order subscriptions, benefit events, and other methods. That's the definition for crowdfunding as the way we know it. So it's a form of alternative finance which has emerged outside the traditional financial system. So crowdfunding is typically done by investors in India. So let's look at the different actors in crowdfunding. So the crowdfunding model is based on three types of actors: the project initiator who proposes the idea or the project to be funded, there are individuals or groups who support the idea, and there's a platform or a moderating organization that brings the parties together. So if you look at India, for example, most of the crowdfunding platforms are for social and artistic causes. So whether you take Keto or take Wishberry.in, or whether you take Start 51, there are many such platforms which look at things more from the social causes. That means they support social causes, artistic causes. Somebody wants to write a book, somebody wants to stage a play. And there are people who want, people who are not so well off, or poor people who require small help for themselves, or what you call through the microfunding route, to get on with their lives, to do very simple things in their lives. So these can also be helped through platforms like Start 51, Keto, and the like. Now we come to the second category, which is companies which actually raise funds for business ventures. So you have companies there like Catapult. Now keeping in mind the fact that now crowdfunding is an increasing or an expanding source of finance, SEBI, or the Securities Exchange Board of India, has started working on norms for crowdfunding. They had already come up with some norms earlier, but they needed to modify these because they have to conform to the Companies Act, which there have been some changes. Before we go back, I'll just go back to that. What crowdfunding companies do is typically they may or may not charge a fee for registration, but many of them charge a fee. Let's come to one more initiative. Called Startup India. As all of you know, we have something going on called the Make in India. So as part of the Make in India campaign, we have the Startup India initiative. So first of all, this was announced in Jan 2016 as part of the Make in India initiative. The way startup is defined is, as per this initiative, it's an entity, a private partnership or limited liability partnership firm headquartered in India, which has been opened less than 5 years ago and has an annual turnover of less than 25 crores. Now, what are the advantages of being declared a startup under the Startup in Start India initiative? But some of the things that they found out, the government found out when they actually came up with this initiative was, many companies had a few queries or some issues through which they were constantly faced. The first part of it was that when companies started operations, in the first 2 or 3 years, they were very keen on going ahead with their operations. And sometimes what did happen was, in the bargain, because they were so caught up and the poor management teams of these companies typically work harrowing times, they work maybe 18 hours a day, things like that. So they are too busy with setting up the business that sometimes they may not realize that parts of the regulatory compliances that they have not taken up have to be completed, and they don't complete them properly. And therefore, they would run into trouble with the regulatory authorities, and that caused them all a lot of problems. So whether it was things like labor law inspections, whether it was things like environmental laws, there was also, for example, not many people to guide them as far as the intellectual property rights or patents, trademarks, copyrights is concerned. So they required some help from the government of India. Okay. Then if you take another part of it, I mean, the government of India, whether and the state governments, they come out with many tenders throughout the year. And many of them, they would actually like companies from the MSME sector, that is medium and small scale enterprises, to contribute to. But certain conditions that they have, they have a condition called, they have to have something called prior experience of a few years, plus they have to have a minimum turnover level. Why? Because the government feels that unless they are in a position to do that, they may not be able to fulfill the contract properly. So the MSMEs or the startups had put forward these issues through a variety of associations and a variety of forums to the government of India. And therefore, when the Start India initiative was announced, it tried to take into account all these what we call the teething problems that startups in India have. So as a result, the government came out with a few conditions which they think will benefit the startups in India, allow them to continue their work and make sure that over time they learn to take care of their responsibilities and all the compliances as any typical corporate citizen should do. So what are these advantages? First of all, if you are recognized as a startup under the Start India initiative, you will have no inspection up to the first 3 years regarding labor laws. So there are certain requirements that other companies have to fulfill. These startups will have some time to adjust to labor laws and make sure that in these 3 years they will comply with labor laws. Till then, they will not have the harassment or continuous inspection and the problems that they have with complying with labor laws during that time. The second part of that is environment. There are many environmental requirements that many companies face, whether they're in the manufacturing sector or the service sector, which they have to comply with. So under the Start India initiative, it's proposed that these companies can use self-certification, and so that they're again not harassed by inspectors, but the intention is again to make sure that in the long term, these companies will still ensure that they follow all the environmental requirements. Now the third thing is, if you talk of intellectual property rights, now that's become critical nowadays, because everything you do, whether it is in a software that you do, or whether it's a packaging design, or whether it's a logo or a brand or a trademark, all of these are very important because they establish the company's goodwill, its presence in the marketplace, and they help in the what we call the top of mind recall for a customer. So companies which are small found this a very expensive proposition to do, and therefore they would end up taking time over this, and possibly somebody else would come up with something similar, and they would lose the advantage of that, or the first mover advantage, in spite of the fact that they had possibly come up with ideas first. So the government has proposed that they will give them a discount of up to 80% in getting the intellectual property rights or the patents. The patent filing procedures will also be simplified for startups in India. And they will be exempted, startups will be exempted from the criteria of prior experience or turnover as far as government contracts are concerned. So companies which are recognized as startups under the Start India initiative will not be subject to the same requirements of prior experience and turnover that other companies normally would have. And finally, they would get an income tax exemption for the first 3 years. Now, if you look at this, the point is that most companies possibly would not even be breaking even in the first 3 years, and therefore the chances their profits maybe would really start thereafter. But even in spite of that, the government has given them this benefit that they will exempt them from income tax for the first 3 years. What are the financial benefits for startups? Now the fact is, when we talk of the very first problem that they have, that is a hindrance, or there's a problem in raising capital. So once they have not been, if they have not been able to overcome that problem, then what is the use of setting up a new initiative? So what the government has done is, it has set up a specific fund of 10,000 crores for new enterprises, with and given them equal opportunity in government procurement, plus a final floor credit guarantee scheme, and easier exit norms. Exit norms is that if the promoters find the company is doing well and they would like to sell out or encash their whatever profit and to get out of the company, it will be easier for them to do so. And finally, you have Japanese venture capitalist SoftBank, which, as you know, all of you know, is one of the large investors in the Indian markets. They have already pledged to invest about $10 billion in Indian startups. So that's also a good, I would say, a shot in the arm, because then there is a possibility of companies, startups, getting money from both the government, and failing that, going back to the private sector as well. Now, how to be part of the Start of India, Startup India options? There are different options that they have. So to be a part of this Startup India initiative, a company has to have a recommendation with regard to the innovative nature of business. Now the point is that the Start India would like to reward companies which have innovations in the business from an incubator. So the recommendation should be from an incubator established in a postgraduate college in India. Otherwise, now these are all options, that is one or the other or the other, or recommendation of incubator which is government funded as part of any specified scheme to promote innovation. So some of the government departments that we have, maybe Department of Industrial Production or Department of Technology, they have certain schemes under which they have incubators, and they're funded those incubators. So companies which are from are part of those incubators would be able to be recognized as startups under Start of India initiative. The third option is that they should have recommendations with regard to the innovative nature of business from an incubator or recognized by the government of India. Another option is they should be funded by an incubation fund or an angel fund or a private equity fund or an accelerator or an angel network registered with SEBI, endorsing the innovative nature of the business. Now, as some of you might know, that the angel investing has become a fairly well-developed market in India. Earlier you had just city-based angels. So you had, let's say, the Mumbai angels, the Bangalore angels, the Hyderabad angels, and Delhi angels, and so on. Now there is something called the Indian Angel Network itself. So you have companies that would like to look for some of the initial capital from the angels, can actually go to the Indian Angel Network and then look for those specific cities or look for people who are interested in those specific sectors. Because some angel investors believe in investing in particular sectors. So some angels might invest only in hospitality, some may invest only in software, some may invest only in, let's say, healthcare, and so on. So companies can go to different angel networks and get the recommendation also from there to become called a startup. Startup should be funded by Government of India as part of a specified scheme to promote innovation. Or they should have a patent granted by the Indian Patent and Trademark Office in areas affiliated with the nature of business being promoted. I'll just repeat. Now, all these are options. That means any of these, if you fulfill, you're liable to be recognized as a startup under the Start India Initiative. So you can fulfill any of these conditions. So what do you have to do finally? How do you have to do? If you want to join the Startup India Initiative, you have to visit their website. They also give a list of incubators. So you can select which incubator either is known to you or is easily accessible to you. You can check out the list of venture capital funds. Even the venture capital funds are detailed there. If your college or institute or company has an incubator or accelerator, you can check it out there as well. And the point is to start off quickly. Then we come to another category which is slowly gaining a bit of popularity in India. That is called venture debt. Venture debt has been there in the US as well. Now it has come into India and it's slowly getting popular. So what is venture debt? Venture debt is any form of debt financing provided to a company that is still dependent on venture capital financing to fund its operations. So how does it help? First thing is there is more fund that is available and it can access more capital to achieve better performance. So if it accesses funds, its turnover goes up, its revenue goes up, and quite simply, the valuation of its shares also go up. So that makes it easier for the company to get future rounds of finance at a far better valuation than it would otherwise have. It enhances financial stability, which is vital for prospective investors and customers. You might hear of companies which are like doing well, they get one round of financing. Thereafter, because they have not yet reached break-even, they almost finish out that round of financing and they are waiting for the next round of financing. If they do not get that round of financing, they have to shut down operations. But if they were able to raise venture debt, then they would be able to work for some more time and have that stability which the customers or their suppliers, all of them, require from them. Third thing, it extends the cash runway. What this means is that there is more time for the company to generate cash and to achieve different milestones. And because it achieves the different milestones one by one, it can look for better valuation and it can also go for the next round of funding. When we mean funding, we typically mean equity funding. Okay. And finally, because it's a debt instrument that is being taken in, it protects equity dilution. You have minimal equity dilution. Venture debt financiers take a very small part of equity capital, but they essentially lend debt. Okay, but the point is, as far as the company is concerned, it's taking a small amount of equity finance, issues a very small of equity, but the debt that it takes, that is much more than the level of equity that it has given to the venture debt the company. But based on that, the valuation of the company will improve far more, so that when it goes to the next series or next round of venture capital financing, the shares will be at a far better valuation, and that will help the company. So how is it different from traditional bank debt? So venture debt is available for early stage companies, bank debt difficult. Promoter pledges or guarantees not required in the case of venture debt, they're required in the case of bank debt. Bank debt also has a lot of restrictions on how the money that is taken, or the loan that is taken, is utilized. That is not the case in the case of venture debt. So people, the companies that take in venture debt have much more freedom about as to the way the funds can be utilized. There are certain check boxes or certain requirements that companies which are eligible for venture debt have to fulfill. So first of all, are these companies already backed by venture capitalists? Have they received some equity funding from them? Is the business viable and with good potential? The third question is obvious, because it's a question of servicing that debt. So if your business is viable and you have a good potential, then your debt servicing can be very good, and therefore you will be able to pay back the all the installments in the principal to the venture debt company. Are you willing to offer the new debt high priority, in the sense that if there is a problem, if the company is close to liquidation, where does the venture debt financials debt stand? Is it at the top priority? Because that's what they would prefer to be. So that it should not happen that if the company has a problem, then the venture debt financier is the last person to be paid off. That should not be the case. And therefore, they will insist on that particular partnership. Finally, what sort of a team do you have? Is your team good enough to carry on the business? Are they good enough to run the business and carry on the business? That's very important. So, quite simply, if the answers to all the above are positive, the company could be funded by venture debt. So, there are a few players in India who are into this business. One of the companies is called Innoven. Innoven was earlier called SVB India, set up by a company called Silicon Valley Bank, which is based in the US. So they set up SVB India, and thereafter, now it's recently, in last year or so, been taken over by Temasek from Singapore. And it was earlier SVB India, now it's called Innoven Capital. So Innoven is one of the pioneers of venture debt in India, and it has been in the business for about 25 years. In India, it's been there for about maybe the last 5 to 7 years. Innoven has, venture debt has funded companies such as Mintra, Snapdeal. Prism Payments is a company which is into the back end processing for ATM networks in India. And Yatra, as all of you might know, is into the travel business. There are other players in this business. One of them is called Trifecta Capital. If you look at the size of this venture debt business in India, it's not very small. It is still, potential is about $300 to $500 million annually, and that might go up in future. What are the different platforms through which, not the conventional ones, where you can actually raise finance? There are two SME, there are SME platforms and there are SME unlisted platforms on the stock exchange that we have. So BSE has two platforms. One is called the normal SME platform, where companies come in, they can list themselves. They're not on the main board of the exchange, because there are some relaxation in the conditions or the eligibility criteria they have compared to the listing on the main exchange. So for the SME platform, you have companies have to have a minimum net worth of 3 crores. Of course, you should pay up equity of 3 crores or distributable profit for 2 of the last 3 years. Promoters cannot be changed for the last one, should not have been changed the last 1 year prior to listing. There are 134 companies listed as on date on the BSE SME platform. Trading may not be, will slowly pick up as these companies start to get popularity. These companies can also graduate to the main board of the BSE exchange. We have a similar concept on the NSE, which is called the Emerge. To go back to the BSE, it also has an SME ITP, which is Institutional Trading Platform, where this trading takes place on a private basis or an unlisted basis between the institutions or between investors on a private basis. So there the requirement is company's net tangible asset of 1 million or net income of 50 lakhs. That this enables SMEs to raise capital without going for IPOs. This ITP will provide easier entry and exit options for informed investors like angel investors, VCFs, that is venture capital funds, and PEs, that means private equity investors. Besides that, there are other platforms where angel investors can actually start trading or fund companies, sorry. So one of them is called Let's Venture. Let's Venture allows companies and investors to meet and connect, and therefore it serves as a platform where investors can contact companies, look at their requirements, look at their business plans and different things, and therefore decide whether to invest or not in those companies. So Let's Venture allows basically companies to raise money. The difference between that and Grex or Growth Exchange is a Pune-based entity which is about 2 years old. That has not just an option for primary raise of capital, it also allows a secondary trading of those funds, those investments by investors. The only difference is that this is unlike the BSE or the NSE. This has a it's a private and unlisted platform. So one has to be a registered investor to get onto that platform, and once that is the case, you can either take part in an issue, or if you have the shares with you, you can offer them for resale to somebody else. So the point is, to conclude, what we are saying is that innovation leads to investment. So it's not that we are now stuck with only the banks or with only the major stock exchanges as the only places to raise money for new ideas. So there are many options available for entrepreneurs to raise the capital. The investment is available from the government through their Start India initiative, and once that takes off, it will help the SME sector and the MSME sector to really do far, far better. The fact is that on one hand, the government there has given them the possibility of access to capital. The second point in the Start India initiative is that there is going to be less regulation, and that will help the promoters and the entrepreneurs to concentrate on their business for the first 3 years and really do what they're, good at. That is setting up the business and making money. In the long run, both the government and the entrepreneurs will benefit from the whole thing. Finally, I would say that if you innovate, there is no shortage of investor capital. If you have a great idea, if the idea has great potential, if it is unique, if you know how to differentiate yourself from the others, then you will always be able to get money and also to make money. So that's all for now. Thanks a lot. Any queries? Any of you can maybe chat and ask queries. I'll be glad to answer them.
Hello. If
Yeah.
anyone has any queries, they can just post it in the comments below, and then Mr. Jaideep can answer them for you. Thank you. So Dhruti asks, what can be termed as angel investors?
Angel investors are those who join in or they make an investment right from the very beginning. So if you look at the very term angel, it's that somebody who wants to do something good for you. So you are at that time maybe faced with the problem of actually getting money. You go to your friends, well-wishers and all that, and still you don't know whom to go to. So these are people who don't mind putting in their money, knowing fully well that in the whole venture capital field, the basic intention or the basic understanding of investments is quite simply this, that out of the 10 investments you make, maybe 4 will actually make a lot of money, and that covers up the losses that you make for the other 6 of them. But the point is, angel investors are those who are ready to take that loss as well, who are ready to put their money and help out somebody who they think, whose business idea they think deserves that help. So it deserves support, and therefore, in a sense, they are angels for your cause. Yeah.
So Divyam Tripathi asks, are you aware of the current status of the DIPP joint committee that will give certification to the startup?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Are you aware of the current status of the DIPP joint committee that will give certification to the startup?
No, like I said, you have to go to the website. There is a different, one second, I can. You have to go to the Start India website and write to them, and they will answer your queries directly. That's the way it is. I would not have more details of the panels, but DIPP has certain conditions, and based on that, and they have set up the Start in India initiative. So queries, you have to ask them directly. One second. Yeah. See, what they have done on their part is that they have given you different options. If you want to check out whether incubators, accelerators, venture capitals, you have to go and check out those things. They also have a toll-free number. They also have a actual email ID where you can write to them directly and get your queries answered from them. And they're supposed to answer them very quickly, because a lot of this initiative has come directly from the PMO.
Priyansh Mehta asks, I'm still confused between venture debt financing and venture capital funding.
I'm sorry, repeat that.
Could you help answer Priyansh Mehta on venture debt financing and venture capital funding? The difference?
Yeah. Okay. When we normally talk of venture capital financing, we're talking of equity financing. So when we talk of venture debt financing, we're talking of venture debt. The only common thing is that, venture debt financiers take a very small part of equity in your business. But if you talk of venture capitalists, they are not there only buying equity, directly only equity. All their funding comes through equity only. Venture debt, it's almost totally through debt. So there's a huge difference in the two. So when you take venture debt, you're not really giving any, there's no major, no dilution or a very, very insignificant dilution of your equity capital as far as the financier is concerned. In the case of venture capital, you're actually diluting, or you're actually selling out some of your equity, that means when I say your, I mean the promoter's equity, to the venture capital fund. So your part of your shareholding gets taken over by an outsider, which is not the case in venture debt. So similarly, in the case of venture capital, since equity is paid out dividend and you're not making much money in the initial years, you may not be paying out much of dividend, but the point is that your equity valuations go up. In the case of venture debt, there will be some interest to pay, so therefore there will be an outgoing of a fixed component or interest component, which will be there in the case of venture debt.
Rahul asks, what debt to equity ratio should be kept by startup company?
Starting a company, that depends actually on the type of business. Some businesses are where they require maybe a lot of capital equipment, you might start off with a higher debt equity ratio. Ultimately, that all of you, anybody who's has some idea of finance would know that you would like to get your debt equity to anything near 1 or below 1. That is the ideal situation to be in. So it depends on the, for example, if you take the case of, let's say, a manufacturing company, they might invest a lot in buying new machinery. So there maybe you might have to, you might actually take the option of debt, because possibly that amount of equity you may not be able to get it so easily. So you might start with a smaller amount of equity and a higher amount of debt. But as you start production and you start making revenues, you will slowly start repaying your debt and move towards a lower debt equity ratio. In the case where you don't have a capital heavy business, that means you're not buying significant amounts, you're not having major capital expenditure, then your debt may be much lower than the comparatively. So like I said, the debt equity ratio depends on the business that you are in, even at the startup stage. And going ahead, like I said, ideal thing is for a company to be debt free, or at least move to a debt equity ratio of 1:1, or debt less than 1, debt equity less than 1.
Rajshekhar asks, so can angel investors also be called promoters?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Can angel investors also be called promoters?
Well, that will actually depend on the amount of shareholding that they get. Because to be called as a promoter, there are certain legal requirements. Only if you have a certain amount of a certain portion in the total shareholding, then you'd be called a promoter. But typically, an angel investor may not be a promoter. Maybe out of, let's say, 100 shares that you have, maybe the promoters that we, either one person or two or three persons together between them, hold maybe 60 or 70% of the shares. And maybe an angel investor comes in for maybe 20, 25 or 30%. It may not be only one person, it could be two or three people, in which case each of them holds, let's say, 10%. So the promoters as such hold much more than that. And the promoters are typically the ones who come in with the idea or with the accounts. They have the business. They come up with the idea of setting up a particular type of business. So they are the promoters of that particular business in that sense. An angel investor is basically an investor. He can maybe at a later stage buy out one of the promoter's stakes and become a promoter thereafter. But that depends on his understanding and his liking of the business.
Hardik asks, what is an incubator?
See, incubator is typically something that is attached to a college or institute. So let's say you have IITs, for example. So in the IITs, you might find that there are certain students who come with new ideas for new gadgets, new machines, whatever it is. So now, since there is a general, I would say, encouragement for many of our people, students or youngsters, to become entrepreneurs. So institutes encourage those people. So what they do is they set up maybe a lab where they provide them the facilities to run those, you know, you can say even the offices to some extent. That means they might give them some office space to work there and start working on that idea. So it's like if you want to incubate that business idea before it actually becomes a full-blown business, or to help them along till that process, from the time that that idea actually is born, that person's is born, to the time it takes to reach a certain level, that is the period which is called incubation. And therefore, these incubators are typically set up by institutes, research institutes, or institutes like the IITs or IIMs. So it's to they use the word to incubate an idea. That's why the word incubator. So, for example, I hope that is clear.
So Dr. Christina asked, what is the current space rate of innovation in India? How much is the current conversion of innovation to investment?
Well, that's not an easy question to answer, because just like to have something that is unique is not very easy. To mention some of the points is that the businesses are maybe not so different, but the way that you approach the business is what makes it different. But there is no hard and fast rule saying that how many of the ideas actually become businesses. If you take, for example, there are so many patents generated all over India in all the research institutes, but there may not be that many people who actually turn those patents into viable business projects. It can happen due to a variety of reasons that something, an idea or some research might look at a very good, might be very useful at the lab level. But when you start doing it at a large scale, it may not actually work out to be so beneficial because there are other costs involved which may not be there at when you do your actual research at the lab level. So it actually depends on the idea and depends on how you find the scale to make it work. Take a simple example, like let's say converting e-waste, what is called electronic waste, into recycling it and converting it into, there are different things, like you can convert to something called carbon nanofibers. There are companies that do it in India. It's basically started off as research projects, and now very few companies are doing it in India. If you try to look at how many computers are used all over India and how many computers are thrown away all over India at a year, on a yearly basis, you might say there's a huge amount of potential in that business. But the sad fact is that there are not so many people who are converting it into business, possibly because there are many other problems. Like if you need to set up a factory to do that work, you have to have the land, to buy the land, you require so many clearances for setting up a company. All that is not the case when you're doing it at a lab level. So it would be great if you have more sort of innovations actually converted into viable businesses. But to put a percentage, I would say is a difficult thing, because many of the things that you do at a smaller level are maybe not so easy to implement at a much, much larger level.
Divyam Tripathi asks again, how soon do you see the mobile app portal coming up that allows registrations for the startup?
I don't know. I saw the website myself and they said that we'll be doing it soon, we'll be doing it soon. So I would be glad to see that happen as early as possible. But I suppose till then we'll have to manage with what is there on the websites. There is an intention to do it quickly. Maybe it takes slightly more time because the government involved, not a private party. There's no level of competition in setting up such a portal or such an app. Well, if we are doing the same app at a very private business level, we have a lot of competition, therefore we'll be in a far greater hurry to do it. Maybe the government has its own reasons for so many clearances involved, therefore maybe that will take slightly more time than if you were to do it at a private app level. Yeah.
Hardik asked, in IPO, subscribers to IPO can be called angel investors?
IPO subscribers?
Can they be called angel investors?
May not be really the case. For one, right now what's happening is that it could have been a possibility 10, 15 years ago when companies that were coming to the capital markets came to the capital markets for the very first time. Most of the companies that come into the capital markets today already have some history, have been in business for 3 to 5 years, and most of them do not come into the markets with issues at par value. About 15, 20 years ago, many of the companies that came into the capital markets came in with shares issued at par, that is at 10 rupees per share. So in a sense, maybe the public would have been angel investors at that time, but they are not angel investors today because these companies anyway come in above par. So they have already done a certain amount of, that's a basic eligibility requirement that they have to have some history before they actually start going to the public for raising funds. So today the public is not an angel investor.
So Divyam asked, apart from the Startup India initiative mandate requirements for registrations, can you just mention a few other rules or regulations that have to be followed?
Besides the Startup India initiative,
Yeah.
well, see, we can, if a company is not part of the Startup in India initiative, it can anyway go the conventional route. It can just, as I said, you can go to the, you can pitch directly to angel investors. You can go to the any of the angel networks and directly pitch for business, for business there. You may not have to go through the Startup India route, but the Startup India route gives you certain other benefits, like the income tax benefits, like the fact that you would get some discounts on the patent cost that you have. It will give you some exemption from you know, regulatory you know, problems that you have in the first, typically in the first 2-3 years. So you would have those benefits by being part of the Startup India initiative. That would not anywhere stop you from trying to access private, you know, venture capital in any manner, whether it's angel investors or VC funds or seed capital funds or anything. So I think the Startup India initiative would help you to take care of some of the problems or some of the issues that a lot of the startups actually face when they start business. So I think that is more important, not so much the funding. That route is anyway open to you. You can go whichever route you want to, but the benefits you can get on the regulatory and to some the fact that you can also try for government business, which would not be the case if you're not registered under this initiative. So I think there are certain benefits in doing that. It could, however, not stop you from seeking your own benefits, seeking your own ways of finance or running your own business even otherwise.
Okay, so we have the last question for this session. What role a promoter plays in a startup company?
Well, the promoter is the person who anyway is the person who's given birth to that particular idea. So it is his job to run the company, and to any investor, he has to be the person who has to explain the concept, because he knows the concept very well of that business. Why he thinks his venture is unique, why his business idea is unique, what is the level of competition, what is his team, and most importantly, why should an investor at any level fund his operations. So if there is nobody, if there is somebody who has a commitment to the business, which is the most important thing, it is a promoter. So only if the promoter is there for some time, and that will ensure that the business has some stability and that it will actually work the way it is supposed to. If I as a promoter come up with a venture, take some capital from that and leave the very next year, there is no guarantee that that business will continue, and therefore there is no guarantee that the person who is investing in my business will make any money out of it. So it's very important that the promoter has to be not only ready to explain his business, but also carry him on his business for some time at least. Only then is it worthwhile for an investor to invest in that business.
Thank you, Mr. Jadeep, so much for participating with us. All the participants had a really nice time, as they've mentioned in the comments. So if anyone has any more questions that they would like to ask in the future, they can always email elearning@thematicus.com. And yeah, thank you.
Thank you.